Welcome to the Electricity of Life, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. Life forms sense magnetic fields, likely in a variety of ways. Electromagnetic forces are as much a fact of life at the biological scale as they are at the cosmic. Magnetite is a mineral with high magnetic sensitivity. While originally thought to be exclusively a product of high temperature and pressure conditions, for some decades now it has been known that organisms can synthesize it themselves. Nanoscale particles of magnetite can be found binding to a microtubule's tau proteins and the tubulin lattice itself. This has been revealed using fluorescence microscopy by scientists at the Institute of Biochemistry and Biophysics, University of Tehran. They surmise that biogenic magnetite in cells, by way of its tiny magnetic field, serves as a mechanism for augmenting the electronic pathways of microtubules. It appears that these nanoparticles might also have a role in guiding the microtubule's growth process, although excess magnetite in the brain will actually impair their growth and operation. This appears to occur substantially in Alzheimer's disease, where one can observe a disorganized surplus of these tiny magnetic crystals, possibly created by oxidative stress. This excess may result in a bedlam of interfering magnetic fields. Interest in this biological mineral was sparked by the initial discovery of orderly chains of magnetite on the back of bacteria that align themselves with magnetic north. A few years ago, a sizable study by scientists at the University of Duisburg-Essen cataloged a tendency for cows to similarly align themselves with magnetic north. Of note, the study which claimed to refute these findings was quite unpersuasive. Besides inaccurately identifying bales of hay as cows, it made further mistakes detailed here. But do cows have the same magnetoreceptor that bacteria do? A recent scientific study examining the current bevy of biological research on magnetoreceptors suggests that magnetite may not be the component responsible in vertebrates. This 2015 article from scientists at the University of Western Australia and University of Queensland argues that we still do not know how other common magnetic substances in the body might be utilized, or what such structures might look like beyond the magnetosomes of a bacteria. In a previous model of magnetite-based magnetoreceptors, it was calculated that single-domain particles might open ion channels as they turn slightly under the influence of geomagnetic forces. But might some of the many nanoparticles binding directly to microtubules in neurons provide magnetic input to organisms? It is also wise to consider what systems of magnetoreception operate together, either in tandem or because one system has more recently evolved and now works alongside an older and less powerful one. Cryptochrome is one such case. These photoreceptive proteins have been studied as regulators of circadian rhythms in both animals and plants. However, effective experiments in new models of cryptochrome's magnetically sensitive molecular physics have led many biophysicists to posit its added function as a magnetoreceptor. This is readily demonstrated in an experiment that uses cryptochrome from the eyes of one species which rarely employs it, ourselves. When one of the two types of cryptochrome present in our eyes is transgenetically given to fruit flies, those flies are imbued with the ability to perceive magnetic fields. Cryptochrome possesses orientation-dependent light stimulation of the FAD molecule held within it. This light-excited FAD molecule then gains an electron from an array of three neighboring tryptophan amino acids. For about 1 millisecond, FAD can hold on to that electron and remain in a signaling state, until something removes that gained electron, possibly an interaction with O2 negative. Each of these transition states, that of gaining and losing an electron, ought to be affected by geomagnetic forces acting on the unpaired electrons. Thus, concerning how they may allow organisms to see magnetic fields, here is what the optical experience of such magnetic guidance is believed to look like in birds. Remembering Robin Baker's experiments on magnetoreception in humans, which at least suggest a magnetoreceptive sense, many a science enthusiast will no doubt boldly wonder how easily humans might reawaken this hypothesized magnetic sight. The sight picture shares some speculations useful to this endeavor. For instance, that humans may have lost their magnetic sight for adaptive reasons. Specifically, perhaps the highly reactive O2 negative around cryptochrome has been willfully or happenstantially diminished in supply. Perhaps our cells are no longer stocking this highly reactive and potentially dangerous fuel for this magnetic sensor. But perhaps the most fundamental electromagnetic antenna in a life form's body is actually its DNA. Professor Reba Goodman is a geneticist who worked alongside Barbara McClintock on her 1983 Nobel Prize work. Reba's own specialty of knowledge is in the field of epigenetic research, studying how electromagnetic fields influence DNA. A fractal antenna is a structure that conducts electromagnetic waves and uses self-similarity in its design to respond to an increasingly broader range of vibrational frequencies. The double helix of DNA conducts electrons, and experiments have identified at least one formatting sequence, which is directly sensitive to electromagnetic fields. According to a significant body of experimental work, DNA's intricate patterns of self-similarity and its electronic conduction imbue it with the properties of a fractal antenna. It picks up a broad range of frequencies, which interact with genes flanked by the electromagnetically sensitive formatting sequence. By some mechanism, different genes accompanied by that sequence will respond to different EM frequencies. This can also stimulate the synthesis of associated proteins. Many scientists would likely believe that such non-thermal radiation cannot influence biological systems, especially in this profound way. But the arguments one usually voices are but a repetition of old assumptions and sporadic evidence that don't measure up to the weight of evidence in the field of modern biophysics. As Reba Goodman's longtime colleague Martin Blank, a biophysicist at Columbia University, has said, most public voices simply have little to no exposure to the relevant literature. Here one can see an interesting debate between different opinions on this issue, centering on matters of health policy for health safety measures around human-made electromagnetic infrastructure. As the research of the Thunderbolts Project community continues to highlight little-known corners of human knowledge for the betterment of all, thank you to the Thunderbolts Project Patreon supporters. Your investments support the selfless pursuit of scientific revelations and productive discussions for our species. And thank you to the community of viewers for having an interest in these scientific topics. The pursuit of open-minded and accurate thinking will enrich culture and make it freer. And also thank you to the game developer Unknown Worlds for donating this excellent music to accompany future episodes of The Electricity of Life. For continued episodes of the Electricity of Life series, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.